All right. Hey ho, let's go. Welcome to Legends and Losers. My name is Christopher Lochhead, and I am very happy that you are with us today. And off the top, I want to tell you, Colin is not with me on this segment. And from time to time, we'll have to fly solo missions. I think Colin's off doing something very, very legendary. And the way we shoot the show, just so you know, is we have the dialogue with our guest first. And then we shoot the front end and the back end around the guest. And so we don't do it all together, mostly because of scheduling. And so the segment you're about to hear with our guest today, who is extraordinary, her name is Ann Miura-Ko, and I'll tell you about her in a second. We shot a couple days ago, and Colin was able to join for the discussion with Ann. So you'll hear him during that discussion. So let me tell you a little bit about Ann. I've known her for almost a decade. And she is a co-founder of one of the most important venture capital firms in Silicon Valley called Floodgate. And as you probably heard on one of our prior shows, we had our partner, Mike Maples, on. So it's great to have the other founding partner of Floodgate. And, you know, she shares with us some amazing stuff about how to be world-class, power of competition. And she also sits in an interesting spot because only 7% of women at top-tier venture capital firms, according to TechCrunch, only 7% of partners at top-tier venture capital firms in Silicon Valley and beyond are women. And she's been called one of the most powerful women in startups. And you know, the conversation we have with her is a very interesting one. I don't know about you, but often when I see legendarily successful people, particularly people who are, younger, Anne's had a lot of success young in her career, you know, you think, wow, they just must be gifted. This is just what happens to them. Life just must be easy for them, et cetera. And especially for somebody like Anne, who is clearly, clearly wicked, wicked smart. And I think you'll get a different perspective on how an extraordinarily high achiever, you know, they have the same insecurities. They're the same as you and I. They have the same fears. And so it's really interesting to unpack, you know, as we get further and further on this Legends and Losers mission to unpack the losery side, not just the legendary side. And so Anne shares with us that she felt like a misfit growing up. And how she found her passion and how she became the most powerful woman in startups in Silicon Valley. And it reminds me, there's a quote from a gal named Tiffany Jackson, who's the author of a book called 12 Keys to Success for Misfits, Weirdos, and Introverts. And she says, anything that causes you to change who you are just to fit in is not good for you. And so you'll hear Anne talk about, you know, advice that she was given, direction she was pushed in, and some of the which she accepted because it felt right. And the stuff that felt wrong, she had the courage of her conviction to, you know, to really stand her ground and focus on what she felt was going to be her passion and where she could make a difference and have the most fun. It also reminds me, you know, talking about misfits, of one of my favorite quotes from Tom Waits. Tom Waits said, God protects drunks, fools, and little children, and dogs. And so I don't know if God protects misfits, if you consider fools misfits, but it is interesting that, you know, so many people who are supposedly misfits end up going on to lead such extraordinary lives, and that is absolutely Ann Miura-Ko. It also reminds me of one of an interesting thing we say in our book, Play Bigger. In Silicon Valley, failure is a feature, not a bug. And so it's always interesting to me if you listen to our show with Colton Brown, the Olympic judo competitor who hopefully is going to bring home gold for the United States in 2020, you know, where he talks about how he fails every day in training and practice. And that's just part of it, and that's part of the process. So before we get to Anne, I wanted to share with you something that I saw recently. There is a gal who is a very celebrated psychotherapist and clinical social worker who's been called the self-help guru of the moment by The Guardian. and Forbes refers to her as a thought leadership star. Her name is Amy Morin, and she's written an incredible book, and she's got this great article out. It's out on her website. I think it was also on Psychology Today, called 7 Ways Mentally Strong People Bounce Back from Failure. And so I thought, as a precursor to Anne, I could share these with you. Number one, they keep failure in proper perspective. Number two, they practice self-compassion. I don't know about you, but this is one I could use some help with. I tend to be very hard on myself, and I think a lot of us are. Three, they choose to be grateful. Four, they respect their vulnerabilities. Wow. Five, they acknowledge their strengths. Six, they create a plan to become better. And seven, they maintain a healthy self-worth. So I share with that with you as a front end to our discussion with Anne, because in a lot of ways, Anne Miura-Ko is very emblematic of all of the traits that Amy is talking about here. So let me share with you a little bit about her background. As I mentioned, Anne Miura-Ko has been called the most powerful woman in startups by Forbes. She's a lecturer and I think an adjunct professor at Stanford. She's a PhD. She's the child of a rocket scientist from NASA, and you'll hear about that. She grew up in Palo Alto, California, in the heart of Silicon Valley, and she's been involved in the startup world since she was a teenager. And some of her investments include Lyft, IASD, Xamarin, Refinery 29, and TaskRabbit and ModCloth. She's also known for her debate skills. You'll hear about that and why those have made such a difference in her career. She's married to a spectacular guy who also has an awesome career. You're going to hear about that. She has 3 beautiful kids, 8, 5, and 3. She's got a BS from Yale in engineering and a PhD from Stanford in math, modeling, and computer security. So without any further ado, our dear friend, Anne Miura-Ko.
I remember being so taken with, and this was my great-grandmother, and her name was Haya Nakatani, and she grew up probably in the early 1900s. And if you can imagine Japan in the early 1900s, and you're probably wondering, like, where does this lead to legendary? This woman was both like an incredible example of being a complete misfit, but she was also this incredible idealist.
How was she a misfit in?
So she was a misfit in a lot of crazy ways. So first of all, she was, while my great grandfather was out, and he was part of the military at the time, and he was away from the home quite a bit, he had a business on the side. And she basically ran the business. And back then, you're supposed to, as a woman, ask your husband for permission to make any kind of decision. And she never would. She would just go ahead and make all the business decisions. And this is while she's raising 10 kids. She also was an incredible martial artist. So she did this kind of martial art called Yawara. And she was so good at
it. How do you say that?
It's Yawara. It's Y-A-W-A-R-A.
It's interesting. I haven't, not that I should have heard of every martial art in the world, but I haven't heard of that one. Is it a secret martial art that you want to tell us about?
It was apparently made for women, but she was so good at it that other people were very scared of her. And back in the day, you would never walk around alone at night in Tokyo, but she was sort of known to be this woman who was very independent, ran her husband's business, and would run around alone because she could defend herself.
Was she Batman?
She seriously was Batman.
And you got the entrepreneurial side, right? Bruce Wayne,
totally
millionaire and all that, right? And then you have the run around at night kicking ass part. I mean,
yeah.
Did they build Batman off of your grandma?
My great-grandma.
Your great-grandma, excuse me.
I'm half convinced that they did, because she also, there's like all these legendary stories about this woman, right? They used to say that the men would try to walk close to her because they knew that she would protect them. Or you know, she was also very good looking.
Is that how Mike feels about you? Is that why he's always so close to you, particularly at night?
You know, yeah, it is. It's true. I'll protect him. I'll kick someone's butt. And so she was just sort of this incredible, like, misfit in a time when women were supposed to be very docile and submissive. And it got to the point where she was also, the other part that I thought was really interesting about why I think she's a legend, she was an idealist. So she took all the profits from this business and then kind of gave it away to anyone who needed it in the neighborhood, to the point where ultimately she and her husband divorced because they couldn't come to agreement on these business decisions that she was making.
So maybe they built Robin Hood on her then? Is she Robin Hood? And maybe she's Batman and Robin Hood.
She's both. She's both. And she's Superman. But she, you know, in the 1900s, she raises all these 10 kids. They're super well educated. And she was kind of this badass. And so, you know, I've been telling my daughter, you come from a line of women who are independent thinkers that men were scared of, that, you know, that you could chart your own path and your own rules. And that's what it is, you know, to make your own story. And I'm trying to get her to understand. And I think it's a lesson for me too, that the best legends, the people who, you know, do really interesting and amazing things, have a great story to them. Ultimately, A, don't follow rules. B, have these big failures. So someone who was divorced in that period was, everyone thought was just sort of out of their mind. Right?
Do you know what year your great-grandmother got divorced?
I don't know. It was probably in the 1920s, somewhere around there.
1920s, Tokyo getting a divorce. I wonder how you even got that done.
Yeah. So I mean, that to me is, it's not your typical entrepreneurial legendary story, but it's a woman who's, you know, in the early 1900s in Tokyo. And that's the Anne Miura-Ko version of what is legendary.
And so, Anne, if you think about that in your own life story, and now you said your daughter's 10, is that right?
That's right.
And so if you think about, so that was your great-grandmother, then there was your grandmother and obviously your mother, and now there's you and your daughter. So help us with kind of the context of your great-grandmother, what that meant to you as you were coming up, and how you're trying now as a legendary entrepreneur and venture capitalist yourself to impart that to your daughter who's 10.
Yeah. I'm a product of what my mom used to say. I was just a really weird kid. And it literally starts.
You know what Hunter S. Thompson said, right?
No.
When the going gets weird, the weird turn professional.
Yeah. Well, that was me. So, when I was 2 years old, I was living in Michigan. And I only spoke Japanese because my parents spoke Japanese to me at the time. And I decided I hated anyone who spoke English. And so I used to pass by anyone who was speaking English and say something nasty under my breath. And my mom decided that that wasn't going to work in Michigan and that I would have to go to preschool and be socialized. And so my brother at the time is going to a really...
So this angry, what, three-year-old, four-year-old who didn't
two.
Want
to... Two. Yeah. And so my brother's going to this fancy private school kindergarten thing. And she's like, well, maybe we can apply there. So she sends me there. And apparently in the interview, the story goes that I bit both of the teachers who were interviewing me because they spoke to me in English. And so I come out of this interview.
Do you remember doing the biting, Anne? What was on your mind before you actually...
I really pissed off that someone was speaking to me in English, that they would dare do that to me. And so I end up in literally what is a special ed program that is state sponsored. And they, you know...
For violent and abusive children?
For violent children. So it was for like 10 kids. And when I say literally, a short bus would come to our doorstep and pick me up and take me to this state-run program. My mom came to the conclusion pretty quickly that all of our academic hopes should be pinned on my brother and not on me.
Clearly.
It was like the worst start. My mom actually to this day calls me the most improved student that she's ever seen. And it's probably.
Do you think there's a chance you're a reincarnation of your great grandmother? When at 2 years old, you're beating the shit out of people and terrifying everybody and fighting them with your teeth. Well, hey, you, listen, when you're two, you gotta fight with what you got, right?
Yeah, right? Yeah, it wasn't fists. So, I started off pretty slow. And it was interesting.
What's slow for you, though, Anne? I mean, you are, I don't know
relevant.
Anybody.
That's very relevant.
It's pretty relevant, right?
So literally every year after that, so I move out to California and we go into.
How old are you when you came out to California from
four
Michigan?
4 years old.
4.
And
did you bite anybody on the plane? Or
no, I was really good after that. Okay. I think they socialized me properly. I end up in elementary school in Fremont, California. And my brother, again, is academically great. He's gifted. He gets into all of the advanced classes, whatever you would do for a second grader. And I, on the other hand, every year, my mom has to beg for me to get into the gifted and talented program. Every single year. And the teachers would say, you're kind of a pain, Mrs. Mira, but we'll have her retested. Every year I would fail the IQ test, literally fail the IQ test. I would not do well in any of the standardized tests. And the teachers would tell my mom that there was no evidence that I was either gifted or talented. And the only reason I ended up in those programs is because my mom had the tenacity to go in there into the office and just be a pain in the butt.
This kid is fucking talented and gifted. I don't care what you say. That's
every that was year.
And the sad part is she didn't even believe it either, right? So she's like, I know she was on the short bus and she was in the slow class in Michigan, but I'm just going to make them believe that she is not only gifted, but talented.
Hey, she was positioning you very well.
Position yourself or be positioned, right, Colin?
Yeah.
And so like I came from this long line, like years and years of not only like me believing that I was not that smart, but then my mom just kind of willing it into existence on some level.
Did she keep telling you were smart, or how did she will it into existence?
Oh, she just expected it. It wasn't that she.
And you knew that expectation.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it was just always. There was this belief that you would do great things. And my dad used to tell me all the time, you know, greatness isn't something that happens to you. Greatness is a choice. And so, and you find it in every little thing that you do. So it was.
Can you tell us, you're talking about your dad, right?
Yeah.
Can you tell us the photocopy story? I love that story.
So my dad would always tell me, no matter what you do, it has to be world class. And it was like homework assignments would be, is this world class? Like, Dad, it's like a calculator.
It's so funny, you know, because when I became an executive early in life, and so by definition, I was a shitty manager, and I was probably a shitty manager for the 20 years I was in management positions. But anyway, one of the things I learned early on was to do exactly what your dad did, which somebody would bring me something to look at or approve or whatever it was. And before we looked at whatever the fucking thing was, I would always ask him the same question, which is, hey, Jimmy, does this thing that we're now going to go look at, do you think this is legendary work?
It's like my dad. That is exactly.
No, but the number of people who would stop dead in their tracks, it's a long story, but anyway, the net of it is that question, do you think this is legendary, changes everything, right? And that's right. What your dad was doing.
No, it was just like, it would be a homework assignment. He'd be like, hey, is this world class? And I'm like, well, I think so.
Not really.
Like as far
this
as
is the most world class book report on Winnie the Pooh ever done.
Dad.
Where did you settle on your homework with that sort of expectation?
Like, well, he just would be like, he would hold it to an incredibly high standard. It would be like, not only the quality of the work, but like, is the handwriting really exceptional? So like everything was held to that standard, which I think was difficult, but you know, it's sort of the story that Christopher was referring to. When I went to college, my financial aid package also contained work study. So I had to work. I had to find work for 10 to 15 hours.
You mean you had to do a job and go to college at the same time? That's just fucking bullshit.
I think that's BS.
It's total bullshit. Nobody should have to work until they're at least 30. Come on.
Right. Until then, you should just get to surf and ski.
And drink scotch. The three big S's. Okay. Well, there's a fourth, but you know.
I don't want to talk about that. So I'm in college and I'm getting this job and I had two options. One was actually refilling formaldehyde for a biology lab. And then the second was going to work in the office of the Dean of Engineering and filing. So I said, option number two is clearly what a smart person would do.
No, not so much on the formaldehyde.
Not so much on the formaldehyde. So I show up to this job, and before I do, I call my dad and I say, I'm going to this job. I found it working for the Dean of Engineering. I'm going to be doing filing work. And he said, you know, be world class no matter what they ask you to do. And I said, Dad, come on. They're just asking me to file. You know, I'm literally photocopying things and putting it into labeled manila folders and putting it into a steel case thing. And he's like, well, it doesn't matter. Just do it in a world-class way.
Yep.
And so I remember sitting in front of
this. How old are you at the time?
I was like 17 years old. And yep. I'm sitting in front of a photocopy machine, literally thinking to myself, what in the world is world-class for photocopy? And I decide that it's to make it like the contrast is going to be incredible. Like, it's going to be so crisp. It's not going to be, it's going to be exactly straight. No one will be able to tell that it was.
Somebody's going to name you the Xerox Woman of the Year.
I was Xerox like, Ninja. This is going to be the most badass photocopy job anyone has ever seen. It's going to be so fast. And so I did that. And every day I would go in and I would try to figure out a way to automate something a little bit more. And that's sort of what led to a series of opportunities that came my way, where I end up, you know, on a tour of the engineering facilities. The Dean of Engineering asks me to do this.
At Stanford?
This is at Yale.
At Yale.
And then the vocational school. And
isn't that the community college that feeds Stanford? Isn't that how that works?
It is.
Sorry, Yale.
So then I end up meeting the CEO of Hewlett-Packard, and he offers me...
Who was it at the time?
His name was Lou Platt.
Yeah, legendary Silicon Valley CEO, and we all do owe him a huge debt, right?
Yeah, he was an incredible guy, and like he was so humble, I didn't even know who he was, because the dean just says, hey, Ann, you know, can you give this guy a tour of the facilities? And I said, sure. And we're just talking. And I said, I'm from Palo Alto. He said, he's from Palo Alto too. He said, do you want to come and see what I do for a living? And I'm like, who is this guy? I said, what do you
do? Is this weird? Is he trying to get you into the back of a van or something?
And he says, well, I'm the CEO of Hewlett-Packard. I'm like, well, that sounds pretty cool for a spring-breaking externship. So it's just sort of this, like, how do you become legendary in a small thing that most people would think was completely meaningless, that turns into legendary opportunities that you couldn't even dream of? And that's what really proved it out for me was, my dad is right. You know, it's when you decide to be great at something, that's where legends are born.
That's awesome, man. It reminds me also, years ago, there was this Zen kind of career life planning workbook that I bought. And I think the subtitle of it was, I forget the name of the book, but I think the subtitle stuck with me, which is the How You Do Anything is How You Do Everything workbook.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That
I think it's true.
If you're going to be legendary, then you got to be legendary at photocopying.
You develop a habit of caring about things. And I think that when you listen to great entrepreneurs, great leaders talk about their lives and their struggles and how they've gotten to where they are, it's because there's a certain humility that where they start. They And that's part, it's born out of both the capabilities that they had to build, but also the failures that they had to embrace. And I think it's that attention to detail at the end of the day that gets you there.
So if we go back a little bit, you know, when you were a kid and you thought you were stupid and you were biting people and all that, what happens to sort of turn the light on? I mean, most people that I know who meet you, after they meet you, tell me stuff like, that's one of the most intelligent people I've ever met. And so, you know, stupid is kind of the last word that anybody would ever use to describe you. So where were you in life when you should begin to discover that maybe you're not so stupid?
Yeah, so I had this transformation in high school where I used to play piano. And I was pretty good at it, and I would get up on stage, but I was extraordinarily shy. I couldn't say a single word. So my brother would stand next to me, announce my name, what piece I was playing, who the composer was. And in freshman year of high school, I remember standing on stage and thinking to myself, as my brother is announcing my name, this has got to end.
This aggression will not stand, man.
I'm like, this is really bad. And so I joined the speech and debate team.
At what age? Remind us. At what age?
It was ninth grade. So I must have been, 14, something like that? 13?
So at 14, you realized that your shyness and your inability to speak in front of this group and others was just not going to go.
Right. And this is the first time, actually, like, and I start competing, and I'm horrible at it.
As a debater.
As a debater. I'm really, like, the worst debater ever.
So 14 and, begins the debating career.
Yeah. And my parents are just watching this, right? They're like, I go through freshman year, I go through sophomore year, and I have an abysmal losing record.
What made you go continue after freshman year onto sophomore year if you were losing so much?
There's something about it I loved. I just like this man on man, like, competition. Right. And
were you getting better?
No, I was horrible at it. And my mom.
You liked it even though you were losing? Like, put us in your head at the time. Why did you like it even though you were getting?
I have no idea. Like, I just liked that I was becoming also less scared about at speaking in front of a large group of people.
That's huge.
And so my mom eventually pulls me aside. And she says to me, this is not the way you're going to get into college. She's like, you are spending all this time on this one activity. And it wasn't like, I was not diversifying my extracurricular activities, right? I was like all in on speech and debate. And my mom had all these great reasons. She said, first of all, you're a daughter of immigrants. We speak Japanese at home. I can't help you with this. How are you going to be better than anyone else whose parents are lawyers? You know, they're great at arguing at home. The second reason was Pali High at the time in Palo Alto didn't really support speech and debate very well. And so, you know, I was forced to go to Stanford to find coaches and we were like trying to find other people outside of the school.
You don't want to slum it over there, do you?
Yeah, I know. But it was good. How
old were you when you were getting a speech coach at Stanford?
Like 14.
Yeah.
14, something like that. And so then my mom says to me, you should do fencing instead. I hear that's how you get into Ivy League schools. And I remember in that moment looking at my mom and being like, wow, my mom has no idea what is good for me and what is not good for me. Like, no idea, right?
Fencing, young man, fencing.
I'm like, I'm not athletic. I would be horrible at this sport. Like, the only reason it's good is it would be unusual for an Asian girl to be doing it at the time. And so I said to my mom and my dad, I said, you have a lot of good reasons for me not to do this, but give me the summer. Give me the summer. let me see what I can do. I'm going to go to this camp. Let me see if I can become a better debater. And I'm going to prepare. And if in the first two tournaments I have a losing record, then I'm out. And so I spent...
And they're judged, correct? Correct?
They're judged, yeah.
So there's a panel of judges, there's two people, and you're debating. And at the end, just like any other sport that's judged, you get an 8, a 9, a 10, or whatever it is you get, right?
They say, you know, one side wins or the other side wins.
Yeah, so okay.
Like, have you won anything yet?
No tournaments. No. I mean, I'd won a few rounds here and there, but like, no, I'd not done well at all.
And generally, is it, you know, as a fight fan, I'm always pissed when the fight goes to the judges' cards, or because you want to see a finish. But you know, invariably, there are fights, whether boxing or UFC or whatever, where you just go, you know, this fighter won the fight, and yet they're not getting their hand raised. Does that happen in debate, or is it generally pretty obvious who wins the debate?
No, it can be pretty questionable, right? Like someone might win where it's just like, how did that person win?
Okay.
Because it's judged, right? So it's humans judging. So so I could blame the judging, but
you could just continue to blame the judges.
It was so consistent that it was hard to do that.
Yeah.
So I prepare. Like this was back before the internet. So I actually spent the
entire
long time ago. So I spent the entire summer at the Stanford Green Library, and they would announce all the potential topics, and I'm like researching them, and I'm like debating myself. I went to this camp, and then
hold on. There's debate camp.
There's totally debate camp.
Where does one go to debate camp?
This one was at UC Santa Cruz. It was amazing.
That must be the greatest debate camp in history. I mean,
it was amazing.
But when you found your coaches at Stanford, they didn't just have debate coaches just standing around waiting for you to show up. Didn't you have to hustle to find someone?
Yeah, there are people who had done high school debate and had done really well who went to Stanford. And then there was just some people who were just interested in staying within that community and helping students. And so because it's a short bike ride from Stanford to Pali High, it was pretty easy to convince someone who was really into it to try it out. But what was interesting was that as I worked that summer, I came to this realization about competition, which was that my edge was that I loved it. Like my mom was not telling me to do speech and debate. In fact, she was actively trying to convince me not to do it. And I knew tons of kids who were doing it only because their parents were telling them to do it. And because I loved it so much, I would spend more time on it than most other people would. And so I would sit there and come up with all the possible arguments anyone could possibly say about this particular resolution. And then I would figure out the 10 to 20 reasons why those arguments wouldn't work. And what I realized was because of that, I could walk into a round and I would have had already a 90% chance of winning that round. I would have basically won that round before I walked in the door. And so my first two tournaments, I walked in, and this is a person who's never won a tournament in her entire life. Those two tournaments, I went to the final round and I won one of them. And it was sort of this, it was interesting because I remember having a conversation with Mike when we first met.
And you're still 14.
Yeah. And Mike Maples asked me, you know, do you feel like you're over like this notion of like having to please your parents? And I said, you know, I've been over it since I was 14 because as much as I love my parents, I've known that I know better what I can do and what I'm capable of than even my parents, right? Even more than what a test could possibly tell me. Like there's no test, there's no way a person can be evaluated where they can be evaluated for grit, determination, and love of something. And that was such a lesson to me. Because at that moment, like the possibilities opened up in terms of
the moment that you won.
Yeah, where I said, hey, like, everyone thought that I was this horrible debater. And like, my mom, who has been my biggest fan my entire life, is telling me I should do fencing rather than debating. And I've proven that even she can't see what I can see.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, for every single person, you need to have that moment where you see something in yourself that other people don't see.
And how did you stick handle around the doubt?
I think it actually comes back to like something that you love to do. Hmm. I think if you don't really love something, then the negative voices will overtake you. That all the people around you who say, hey, that's a bad idea, will overtake you.
Yeah. And let's complete the story for everybody. So you go to college and you continue to debate, and what ends up happening is you continue your debate.
No, so I didn't continue to debate in college. I did finish up in high school.
In high school.
I took second in California and I took first in the country.
And didn't you debate at all in college?
No, I was burnt out by college. I sang in college.
So in high school, at what age were you when you won it? You're about 18 or 17, something like that?
17, yeah.
You were number two in California, is that right?
Yeah, that was my junior year. And then my senior year, I won this thing called Tournament of Champions, which is one of the two national competitions.
So at 14, or maybe 13, your brother has to introduce you because you're pooping your pants when you got to get up and do stuff.
Yeah.
And by 17,
yeah,
you are the national champion in the United States of debaters in your age.
Yeah.
In school.
Incredible.
So, I mean, like, I think that kind of transformation is possible. And when I saw that in myself, I was thinking to myself, wow, like, this is, it's just such a, it's interesting what personal belief and hard work can get you. And actually, like, loving something, right? Loving something is just so important, because if you love the crap out of something, then you're going to do it more than anyone else. And I've gone back to even Pali High, where our debate team was like a scraggly group of 10 nerds, and now it's like 90 or 100 kids. I've gone back to that team and said to them, if you are here because your mom and dad told you to be here, quit now, because you'll never be great at it. There's no hope, because you're going to be up against someone who loves it 100 times more. And I think that's true in like profession. It's true in life. It's true in everything that you do. This is no fun.
So, Anna, I'm curious, if you loved it so much, which clearly you did.
Yeah.
How did that love dissipate so quickly when you hit college?
Well, in college, it's a very different style of debate. And so you have to adjust to a very different method of debating. And so I didn't love that style. I just really loved the style that I did, which was Lincoln Douglas. And it required sort of a lot of thought and preparation. And it was an individual sport. And the ones that they did in college, at least at Yale, was partnered up. It was more impromptu. And so stylistically, it wasn't something that I wanted to do. And I also wanted to, in college, find something else that I really love to do. And so
are you a good singer too?
I'm okay.
Do you want to sing something for us?
Not really. I'm really like, I'm more of like a karaoke, sing in the shower kind of person.
Are you? What kind of music do you like to karaoke or sing in the shower to?
Like really bad pop music.
Like, give us a couple of songs we might know that you like to. Like
anything by Britney Spears.
Oh, are you, do you Whoops and Do It Again? Is that, are you, yeah, do it all the way back?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oops, it's not Whoops. It's Oops. I Did It Again.
It's Oops. Did I say Whoops? It's,
yeah, you did.
Oops. It's just O's. No, there's no W.
No WH. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, were you at all inspired by Lady Gaga at the Super Bowl? Are you getting your Gaga going? Or
I kind of like that halftime show.
You know, I thought she was fucking, right? She was fucking amazing. And the thing that strikes me about anybody who does something legendary like that. And the first thing is, I love it when there's a moment of truth in somebody's life.
Yeah.
And they fucking crush it, right?
Yeah.
And that's clearly what she did. The other thing that sort of, you got to take a step back and go, hey, wait a minute. It's a 30-year-old woman doing this.
Yeah.
And, you know, I have a niece who's about that age. And after the performance, I paused the Super Bowl and I looked over to my wife, Carrie, and I said, baby, that's a 30-year-old chick who just did that, right?
Yeah.
And I said, you know, think about, you know, our niece Holly and where she is in her life and all that. And I said, and that's just a regular person. There's no difference between her and anyone else. And, you know, I read some criticisms of her performance afterwards. I'm thinking to myself, what the fuck could you, like, she jumped off the top of the thing.
I know.
She did the world's most difficult, the level of cardio you need to do that is,
right,
is like that of a professional fucking fighter. She's live. You can tell she's live. That's not fucking lip sync bullshit.
No. Right?
And the thing, the biggest thing that struck me though is that is one young woman who more than a decade ago said she wanted to be a major star and she fucking made it happen. And there's no difference between her and anyone else, right? This is just one person who grew a set of giant testicles and put on one of the most legendary performances in Super Bowl history. And I don't know, I just look at that and go, shouldn't we take a step back and go, hey, that was awesome.
I thought it was awesome. I also thought she struck like the perfect tone. You know, it was very subtle. It wasn't like crazy over the top political, but it was, yeah. And then it was a great entertaining performance. So.
And so, Anne, you know, to catch people up a little bit, so you then go to university, right? And ultimately, you end up with a PhD from Stanford. Just share a little bit about from, okay, I thought I was stupid. People told me I was, you know, not fitting, feeling like you're on the island of misfit toys, to the day they hand you your Stanford PhD.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of twists and turns in there. I think I was fortunate to meet a lot of people who believed in me for no other reason than they met me and they saw something, and they saw it before I did. And so I told you the story of Lou Platt from Hewlett Packard.
Yes.
I think that was my first experience where he actually sent me two pictures after I visited with him for a week. There was a week where actually Bill Gates came to do an HP.net announcement. And so there's all these photographers around, and I was just kind of watching from the side. And after I got back to my dorm, I get this card from Lou that says, hey, thanks for coming to visit. So he sent me a card. And he said, I thought you would enjoy these pictures. And the first picture is a picture of Lou sitting next to me. Here, wait, hold on. I have it, actually.
Yeah, that'd be great if you could get it for us. There's a little bit of a behind-the-scenes Silicon Valley history. You know, at the time, for those people who don't know, do you think it'd be safe to say that at the time, Anne, that you know, Lou was considered to be in the elite of CEOs in the world?
Yeah. So here's, I don't know if you can even see this.
Yeah, here, let's try and zoom in on you there. Yeah.
There's like Lou Platt and Anne Miura-Ko.
How old is the little Anne Miura-Ko?
That is probably mean like I'm 20.
Yeah.
19 or 20.
And are you, second, where are you at school in that, at that point?
I'm at Yale.
You're at Yale.
Yeah. So I'm like,
what did you study in your undergrad? Tell everybody.
I did electrical engineering.
Yeah.
And we worked on robotics at the time. Autonomous soccer playing robots. Then the big one.
As you do.
Yeah. So the second picture is, you will notice Bill Gates sitting exactly where I had been sitting, right?
Yep.
Talking to Lou.
How awesome is that?
And so that's like the first experience I have of someone just saying, hey, you know, think about that. You're sitting where exactly Bill Gates had been sitting. And up until that moment, you know, I'm thinking research scientist. My dad was a research scientist at NASA. I hadn't really thought of.
It's too bad he wasn't smart, though. That was the only thing.
Was the only thing. But I just hadn't, like, that was the first time where someone very subtly is saying, hey, like, have big dreams, like big dreams. And so, you know, that's my first experience with really a mentor who just suggests something to me.
And so this is an important thing to underscore. You know, one of the parts of our mandate, our mission at Legends and Losers is to be a platform for sparking a breakthrough in entrepreneurship and innovation. And the thing that you're saying that's so interesting, and it was absolutely true for me, and Colin, you know, chime in, somebody at a important point where we're questioning, we're thinking about who we're really going to be, somebody does need to be our advocate, right? Somebody does need to introduce us to the possibility that we could be something legendary. Don't you think that's true for most of us?
I think most of us are like that. I think there's sort of the rare occasion of someone who just like believes unconditionally and just knows where they're going. They're like Richard Branson or something. But I think most of us have some doubts, right? Of like, well, I know what I'm capable of, but like, how do I even get from point A to point B?
And so that experience with Lou, that was a real tipping point for you.
That was definitely a tipping point. But then I have a series of those things where I have, you know, I go into talk to a few people about venture capital. So in college, one of my friends had told me, hey, you're good at technology, you're good at finance and business and stuff like that. Why don't you think of being a venture capitalist in the future? And I was like, I don't even know what that is. And he had, for my birthday, photocopied a directory of venture capitalists. He'd gone to like the School of Management and found this for me. And so that had sort of stayed in my mind. And I ended up, after working for a few years, looking up a couple of venture capitalists, and I ended up meeting Ted Dintersmith from Charles River Ventures. And he had been looking for an analyst, and on the spot, he offers me a job. And this was after not a technical interview. We had literally talked about music we listened to, which at the time was not bad pop music, but classical music. I was on a...
So you were exercising, or you were presenting more of a erudite.
I was more refined in the moment.
Oops, not whoops. I did it again. Image.
Exactly. And then I also was really into reading fiction. And so I was telling him some of the fiction books I was reading at the time. And he happened to be a huge opera fan, and he had studied English literature in college as well as physics. And so we had a great conversation for 2 hours. He then offers me a job on the spot. And I think without even really considering all the details, I accept it. And I'm at the time living in Palo Alto, so I have to move out to Boston. But Ted Dintersmith, again, a person who sort of decides to take a chance on me.
And had you graduated yet with your undergrad?
I graduated, worked for a couple of years, and was thinking about actually at the time going to law school. And I had applied to law school.
Because the world needs more lawyers.
Because my logic was I'm good at technology and I was really good at debate, so therefore I should be a patent attorney.
Fair enough.
And luckily, my boyfriend, who's now my husband, was going to Harvard Law School. And so I realized at that point that law school wasn't really in the cards for me, that I wanted to go back and do something in math. And I had always loved math. I was good at it. It always came fairly naturally to me.
Me too.
And so I said, hey, I don't think I want to go to business school. I don't want to go to law school. I want to go and get my PhD. And so I end up going to...
And at that point, you have your master's?
No, I don't have my master's.
Okay, so you've got your undergrad. You've been in business for a couple of years, but you decide now you want to go for a PhD. And just so everyone's clear, what's your PhD in?
It's in applied math. It's in operations research and mathematical modeling of computer security.
So can you do long division? Is that what that means?
I don't think I can do long division. I can do some math, though, with lots of symbols. And so I ended up applying to a few different programs, got in and decided to go back to Stanford because I wanted to go back home to Palo Alto. And I remember the one thing that was really striking to me was I've been out of school for 5 years and going back to Stanford, and there's like lots of smart people there, obviously. Going to a math class for the first time in 5 years, having not done that much math, was a real jarring experience, especially because you have these really smart freshmen for whom it comes totally naturally. And in the meantime, you can imagine, like, it's like the wheels are slowly starting to turn again and being very intimidated by the people around me. But, you know, the thing that I love.
Isn't it interesting when we put ourselves in an uncomfortable situation that feels like might be beyond our reach, that those are often the situations that force us to figure out how far we can reach?
Yeah, it was.
I mean, those freshmen forced you to take your game up quickly, right?
Oh, yeah. Because they knew what they were doing, and I had no idea what I was doing.
The good news is you could have done flawed math, but with your debate skills, you could have convinced them that your shitty math was actually right.
Yeah, totally.
When did you feel comfortable again?
I don't think I ever felt that comfortable. It's, you know, it's, to me, one of the interesting things about the PhD was there are parts of it I really loved and I felt I was good at. I was really good at teaching. I really enjoyed that. I was good at the research, but when I looked around me, this is where the imposter syndrome really starts to kick in, is that there was a professor who moved in across the hall from me. And I quickly realized that he was this new professor who was my age. And he was brilliant. Like, we would walk into a seminar and he would be able to rattle off 5 different papers and tell us the 3 different authors who had written the paper, plus the methodology behind it, and then basically do the proof of this complex mathematical system in, you know, 10 seconds. He'd be able to do that for like 20 different papers and compare and contrast. And I'm like struggling to remember the second author on the paper I had read that morning, much less the methodology, right? And I'm looking at this, I'm thinking to myself, I'm good at a lot of things. I'm pretty good at this, but I'm not that good at it. And every day at Stanford was this sort of beat down, this emotional beat down of, wow, everyone else is so incredibly good at what they do. And then you'd go to a conference and then you'd be reminded that in the world of things, in the world of experts, in the world of academia, you're not so bad. Like, your research is actually quite good. It's solid, right? And then you'd go back to Stanford and it would be a daily emotional beatdown.
because every day you're playing one-on-one with Michael Jordan and it's humbling.
Yeah. And it's like, this is a person who is my age, right? Like, it's not like I can say, well, he's a lot older and is a lot more experienced. He was my age. And so I just, I remember at that point thinking to myself, I need to find the thing that I'm really good at. That I, you know, this is.
And how did venture capital become that thing, Anne?
Well, I think I was, I didn't go out looking for venture capital. Even the first time when I was at Charles River Venture, it sort of fell in my lap. And this second time, I was thinking of starting a company in the area of my research. So
you wanted to be an entrepreneur.
I wanted to be an entrepreneur, and I wanted to find something in this area of behavioral modeling in computer security. And I felt like risk analysis and math modeling would become more important in computer security and IT security. And so one of my advisors said, well, that's a solid idea. Why don't you go and find angel investors and see what they're doing since you've been in the ivory towers for so long? And so I approached a bunch of angel investors, one of whom was Mike Maples. And Mike was nice enough to say, why don't you come in every Wednesday and we'll take a look at companies together? And so every Wednesday I'd go in and we would hold what we...
And that was it. There was no join me. There was no, just come on in on Wednesdays and help me companies for shits and giggles.
Yeah. And he was just like, let's just do this. We'll call it unpartners meetings. And so I'd go in. Sometimes there are other angel investors there looking at stuff with Mike. And I ended up doing that for a couple of months. And one day I'm driving up to Tahoe to go ski. And at this point, you know, I'm about 2 years out from finishing my PhD. I have a 18-month-old daughter at that point. And Mike gives me a call and he says, I have this great idea. I think you should drop out of the PhD program and come join me at this Maples investment thing that I'm doing. I just raised this small fund and you should come.
How big was the fund? Was it $15 million or something like that?
It was $35 million.
$35 million,
okay. And I remember getting off the phone and thinking to myself that the man must be clinically insane, because the question I had was, well, what in the world do I have to offer, right? I'm a PhD candidate, like loser.
No, I don't. That's when I decided that I'd been a loser as a student, Colin, is when I was a PhD candidate struggling to get in. That was.
But if you think about, like, who's going to be a venture capitalist? Do you go out and search for like a PhD candidate at Stanford? No, you like go look for someone who's operating experience.
Yeah, a grizzled veteran from the tech wars. Or
yeah,
whatever.
Or yeah. Even like if you're going to look for a student, you look for, I don't know, a GSB like business school student, right?
Yeah. Yeah, not an engineering background like yours.
So I just thought, I was like, he's a little bit crazy. And in the meantime, I'm asking some of my advisors, like, well, what do you think? My mentors. And I'm getting advice like, hey, you know, if you're going to do that, go to Kleiner Perkins or go to Excel and be an analyst.
Who are the big firms on Sand Hill Road?
Right. And I said, you know, and I remember thinking to myself, well, none of them would hire me. Like, that's the problem, right? If I wanted to be a venture capitalist, those big firms would.
Kleiner Perkins isn't going to hire me.
Like, there's no reason for them to. And so I had this kind of come to Jesus moment of, first of all, do I really want to be an entrepreneur? Do I want to do this thing that I've spent some time doing research on, and I feel like there's an opportunity there? Or do I turn my attention to this other thing where I see what Mike is talking about? I see it around me. I see it in the students who are trying to start new companies. Mike is talking about 500,000, the new 5 million. There's going to be a whole slew of entrepreneurs who need financing that can't get it from the large VCs who are used to writing $5 to $10 million checks. And the angels, they're frozen right now, because you have to remember, this is 2008. The financial crisis is starting to
People
happen.
Were terrified, yeah.
People are terrified.
Real estate was crashing, all of it, yeah.
Everything's kind of like up in the air. I think Bear Stearns in that moment is going under. And in the meantime, my mom is saying to me, hey, if I'm not mistaken, a venture capital firm is a financial institution, and you realize there's this huge financial mess that is happening. Is this really the time to like quit a PhD, have an 18-month-old daughter, like to do all this now? Like, why now? And I think this is where entrepreneurship comes in. Is
well, the reality is joining Mike at that point was incredibly entrepreneurial, because he was a one-man band, and you guys were now going to go create a firm. And so, even though you weren't an entrepreneur, in maybe the sense that you thought you might be. The reality is you guys were going to then christen the firm Floodgate and move forward. And so it was incredibly entrepreneurial what you were doing, right? And I'm sure he couldn't have the kind of levels of guarantees and things that might make you comfortable if you were going to go join one of the top tier firms on Sand Hill Road, right?
Yeah. And I think there are a few things that I learned out of that, which was, number one, an entrepreneur is someone for whom the idea is obvious to them, but to the rest of the world, it literally is crazy. And if I
do think in that regard, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, but do you think in that regard, at least partially, entrepreneurs are have to do what they do to make themselves feel either not crazy or less crazy?
Yeah, because I felt I think what was interesting to me was I felt an incredible pull towards this.
This being joining up with Mike and starting Floodgate?
Joining up with Mike. And I had felt a pull towards my research. Obviously, I'd done that for 5 years. If I didn't feel a pull towards that, I wouldn't have done that for 5 years. But there was this incredible pull towards what Mike was talking about because I saw the same hole he did. And it was almost like we were talking to ourselves because no one else seemed to see it. There were maybe two or three other firms that were doing it. Y Combinator we went to, there were...
Is it what you might call a market insight, Ann?
Yeah, it was this crazy insight that I felt like we were seeing something that no one else saw. It was the secret that we observed. And it was, you know, if I didn't jump in this moment, and who cares about timing? Like, right. If I didn't do it now, someone else was going to do it, and I would be super pissed. And
was this insight that you saw that what you referred to in one of your talks called the democratization of innovation?
Yeah, it was all around this notion that people were taking advantage of commoditized hardware, open source software, the cloud infrastructure. And you know, at the same time, I'm a grad student who is also running a bunch of servers because in our research lab, you had to run a bunch of servers to do the computations that you needed to. And we're starting to see, hey, you can do this all up in the cloud. And
so you're starting to have the problem that a lot of people at the time are trying to solve, right?
Yeah. And so I'm seeing this and these kids are coming in and they're starting to launch things without having to buy all this, the software and hardware. And it was a real shift. You could see it starting to happen. And with Facebook taking off, there was also this social fabric that had been created that was also clearly something new. So I felt this incredible pull towards what Mike was doing. I also felt Mike was one of these mentors from whom I could learn so much because I am one of those people who's very logical. He calls me Dr. No. I can see all the reasons things will go wrong. And then Mike is the complete opposite, an incredible, hopeless, optimistic person. And an incredible private, one of the best marketers I've ever met. And as an engineer, I was very skeptical of marketing. I used to think you build it, you build the best product and people will come.
You build that product and pray at that altar of the algorithm and everything works, right, Anne?
Everything works, right? Like, why wouldn't people buy it? And I see this talent in Mike that I just want to know more about. And so I wanted to bet on him and his ideas. And so I remember.
But isn't that interesting? If we just pause for a second, right? So there's Mike. You know, and of course I know his journey well because I was there for it, and I'll never forget him moving to Silicon Valley and you know, ultimately starting what was at the time called Maples Ventures. But you know, nobody would give him the time of day. I remember talking to him back then as he was trying to raise the money and so forth and so on. It was very unclear that he was going to be successful. And you know, by the time you guys connect, of course he's got some traction. But the reality is, the interesting thing that's going on here is, you have an unproven entrepreneur in Silicon Valley, in venture capital, in Mike. Now, he's a proven entrepreneur, but he's in a really connected but much different field. He's not starting a tech company, of course.
Right.
And you are a completely unproven PhD candidate. So it's right. Like...
We're a band of misfits.
Yeah, the misfits kind of betting on the misfits, right? Is
right.
That what happened here?
I think that's, it goes back to like my great grandmother, right? It's misfits and idealism. And like a belief that we could build something great.
The other thing about you, I have to say, Anne, is you are one of the most welcoming and easy to be around people I've ever met.
Is not what my kids would say.
Well, yeah, they probably think you're a tiger mom or whatever ass-kicking moms are called these days. But I remember Mike describing you to me because he was obviously insanely excited and going to rechristen the firm and all this stuff, right? And So I was sort of, I got a front row seat as all this was playing out in my conversations with Mike. And as he continued to describe you, I thought, well, she sounds awesome and she's going to fucking hate me.
How do you know I didn't?
Well, maybe you did. I don't know. I'll never forget.
That's how welcoming I am.
The way you made me feel. I expected you to kind of hate everything about me, and you made me feel like the opposite. So maybe you did, and you probably detected my severe mental retardation. But you have a very easy way with your massive IQ and your giant titanium testicles and all of your other ninja skills. To really put people at ease. Where does that come from?
I don't know, maybe because I've been a misfit for so long.
Say more about that.
You know, I know what it's like to be different. And I know what it's like to feel like you don't belong. And I felt like that for a long time, elementary school, even junior high, lots of high school. Like I found my band of misfits in high school and the band of debaters. Like, how sad is that? I mean, but they were amazing people. They've gone on to do amazing things. But I think that, you know, I do know what it's like to not feel like I'm totally understood. And I think that's sort of the thing that you see in entrepreneurship a lot of times is there's this real fine line between, we call it being visionary and having visions. And you want to make sure you're betting on the right side of that line. But that's what I love about early stage is that when someone is just starting up a company, I know what it's like to have other people look at you and think that you're absolutely nuts, right? And I remember in that first year, actually, when I started up Floodgate, I had to tell my PhD advisor that this is something that I was going to do, and he was really supportive. I felt like I wanted to still finish the PhD, so I said, look, I'll wake up really early in the morning, I'll do it.
Which, of course, you did.
I did. The other crazy part was I became pregnant with my second child. I think
so. Let's just unpack this for a second, just because I want people
there's
to
a
get
lot going on here.
What was going on? So, you are co-founding Floodgate with Mike.
Yeah.
You are completing your PhD. You're caring for a child who at the time is how old?
18 months.
18 months and boom, let's go make some more people because we don't have much going on. So let's make some more fucking people. That's what you did.
Yeah. The craziness was even worse. Like at the time, because in venture capital, when you join a firm like this, you also put your money into the firm.
Right.
And when you're writing a check into a company, you're also personally writing a check. Now, up until that point in grad school, I was making something like $25,000 a year. And my husband's just getting started in his career. And what I found was that immediately starting Floodgate, I now have a negative income because I'm writing checks into these companies. And
invest in the fund, right? That are investing in the companies.
And my husband's like, let me get this straight. You're finishing your PhD. We're pregnant with our second child and we're paying for you to work. You actually have...
Oh, and by the way, you're investing all these companies that have less than a 1% chance of financial positive outcome in the future, right?
Right. You have a worse...
But other than that, you're on fire. It's awesome.
It's awesome. Like your income has actually gone down from the time you were a PhD grad student. Like this is great, Anne. Like what are we doing here? And again, in those moments, it's like, who are your support network? My husband was willing to take that bet and let me ride. You know, Mike is giving me this opportunity to start writing checks. And then the third element is there are entrepreneurs out there who decide to take a chance on me. We always talk about like, oh, the VC is making this grand bet on an entrepreneur. But if you think about it from the entrepreneur's perspective, who's taking money from this massively pregnant PhD candidate who's never really made any investments before. You got to give mass kudos to the founder of TaskRabbit, Leah Buskey, the founders of Lyft, John and Logan, and then, you know, Susan Koger from ModCloth. They were taking as big a bet on me as I was taking on them, probably bigger on their side.
Well, and I almost hesitate to bring it up, but I will, because it's just been so much in the media over the last couple of years that kind of women in business, women in technology, women in venture capital, women in Silicon Valley. And so we just have to ask you a little bit about that, Anne. You know, there you are, essentially starting a venture fund with let's call a spade a spade, a baby, and you're making another baby, and there you are, you know, making these early investments in companies like Lyft and TaskRabbit and so forth. So, you know, it's easy to look at you and go, holy shit, this woman is actually, well, no kidding, because her great-grandmother was Batman and Superman combined, and so... But I guess my question is, how the fuck do you do all that, and help put this into context for us in light of all the discussion about women in tech and women in business?
Yeah, so I think there's a few elements to how this ends up working. Number one is I have to give massive credit to my husband, because he comes home, he does his own laundry. He does the dishes. He's cleaning up around the house as much as I am, maybe even more. And he's not. It's not
does
like
he want to come over to my place.
Probably not. There's enough things to do at our house. But he.
What, you mean your like 17 children?
Yeah, it's not like he's not busy. He is. He right now he's the GM of Mint and Intuit. Right. And so
that's not a big job. I mean, come on, general manager at a giant division of Intuit. He's just a slacker in his career.
So he's probably way more busy than I am, but he comes home and he pulls his weight. So that's key number one. And more than anything, he's interested in my career. He's interested in the things that I'm doing, and he's personally very proud of my achievements. Remember, one of my students actually went to go interview an Intuit, and they were going to interview with my husband, Al. And she asked some of the other people who had worked with him before, like, what's the secret here? Like, what should I do? And the other student said to him, you should ask him about his wife. And she was like, well, that's weird. Who's his wife? They're like, oh, it's Anne Miura-Ko. She's like, oh, I know Anne Miura-Ko. So that makes it a little bit more natural. But I always thought that was just so sweet and a little bit weird, but sweet, because he does, I always do feel like this incredible support coming from him. The second thing is my work husband, which is Mike, who also has, you know, because he's a real dad. He takes his son to school.
He's a single dad.
Yeah, and he takes his son to school. He has doctor's appointments he has to worry about. And
he goes to games. He goes to the school functions. He does all that, right?
He's an involved father. And so, you know, it's on his calendar. As much as, like, my kid's stuff is on my calendar, he has his family stuff on his calendar. And so it's never been this thing that I've had to explain to Mike. And so I don't have to talk to him about, okay, I need to go to this doctor's appointment. Let me tell you more about why I need to be there. It's been a very supportive environment from that perspective.
So you just do what you need to do, and he does what he needs to do. And
there's no guessing and checking. And then the last is that, like, and as a result of that, I think we have a lot of women who work within Floodgate. There was a point in time where Mike was even saying, you know, I'm the only dude here, and there's like four women around me. Like, can we get a guy in here? Please. I need to talk.
Wait a minute. I just want to understand this. So there's a venture capital firm in Silicon Valley where at one point the testosterone was seriously outnumbered and...
He was feeling threatened. He thought it was a little bit of a hostile work environment. And I told him, well, Mike, we're not going to lower our standards to hire a man.
Just to hire men, yeah.
So you're going to have to deal with it.
So the last three or four hires at Floodgate, any of them men?
Yes, we finally found men who actually met our standards.
So it was hard, but there was finally a man you could find in the domain of business, finance, and entrepreneurship that could
meet the bar.
Yeah.
Could meet the bar. It was tough, but we worked
hard. I applaud that for you meeting your diversity goals.
It was tough. It was tough for a moment there. But yeah, I think that diversity, actually the gender neutrality actually within our firm from the get-go, really helped, because we didn't actually have to retrofit for either gender coming into our organization. And then the last piece is, you know, my parents actually live really close, and so they're always helping me out with kids and activities. And I have like the world's most amazing nanny right now who helps out with our kids and answers like the 10,000 question my 5-year-old likes to ask in any given day.
It's interesting you mentioned your nanny. I remember when Sheryl Sandberg's book Lean In came out, and obviously it's been a seminal book for a lot of reasons. One of the criticisms at the time I remember hearing was like, oh, well, it's really easy for Sheryl Sandberg to say lean in because she could hire 4 billion nannies and chauffeurs and rant, rant, rant. And, you know, I'm not even going to address that, but for you, you couldn't hire 4 billion nannies because you weren't making any money. And to your point earlier, you were actually paying money back into your firm. And so
yeah.
The amazing thing about sort of the women in tech discussion about your story is, you know, there you are, newly married, newly pregnant for the second time, and you're not hiring a billion people, and somehow, because of your relationship and because of who you are and your environment, your family, et cetera, you make all that work.
Yeah. I think if I had to map it out and say, here's what would need to get done in order for all of this to come together, it would have been an impossibility, right? Like I would have been too daunted by what got mapped out in front of me. But like when you're in the thick of it and you're just doing it, it's just like a hand-to-hand combat every day. You know, you're like I remember for a long time, my kids were in daycare, and I would, I was that mom who would come screeching into the parking lot at like 6 o'clock. And my children would be at the gate, like sucking on the gate because they were the last children there. And there's like no one else.
We're so neglected.
Their knuckles bleeding. Holding the gate.
Totally. And then I'm like, oh, I'm like totally that mom. But you know, they survived. They're well adjusted, at least for now.
Toughened them up a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, if you think about your venture capital career now, I mean, you and Mike got together approximately a decade ago. Am I remembering that right?
8 years ago.
8 years
Almost
ago.
Almost nine. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, for a guy who failed grade 10 math, that's a decade. We'll just. And now people refer, they have all these titles and shit they give you, you know, the most important woman in startups in Silicon Valley, that you've been called the number one woman in venture capital, all these things. In 8 years, and you've created and now are raising this family. What do you have, 14 children?
3. Feels like 14.
I'll never get one because you just kept having them. Essentially, from the time I met you,
I was like pregnant for a really long time.
You just kept having children. I thought, wow. Literally, I just completely in awe of how is it this woman can do this. So I guess, Anna, you know, as we bring this thing home, what advice would you have for people who want to learn from your experience and your journey of going from feeling like a complete misfit who was thought not to do well at school to ultimately becoming a PhD and an adjunct professor and one of the most important venture capitalists and entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley?
I think the key is actually finding things that you really love to do more than anything else, and then choosing to just be great at it. It's a combination of the advice that I've gotten all across my career, which is, you know, if you're waiting for luck to happen to you, it's never going to happen. You have to grab opportunities and shake the tree and figure out like where you're going to head, and you have to run in that direction like you are the person who needs to win that race. It's that commitment to finding something that you will be absolutely awesome at. And And I think too often people are just satisfied with a job and being busy and, you know, making it sound like you're doing a ton of different things. And they don't take that step back to see if it's all worth it. And the reason I'm lucky is that I have these impossibly cute kids who hang on to my leg as I'm leaving for work every day. And every day I have to make that choice to leave them. And I have to say to myself, it's worth it. Because when I leave, I'm going out to do something that I believe in, that I absolutely love, and I promise I will be great at. And if I can't make all those promises to myself and to my kids, it's not worth it.
Wow. I don't know that we can do anything better than that. Colin, do you have anything to add?
Well, no, I mean, not to add, but I think that it really brings home the point that Mike made when he was delivering his talk about Dare to Do Legendary Things. And he said that there was a point in the talk where he got almost emotional. And
he always gets emotional.
And he was, the message he was delivering was that he was urging the Stanford students to only do things they think have a chance to be legendary and always work with people who excite you. And that sounded like he was really reaching out to you at that point. And it sounded like you guys have an incredible chemistry that you've been able to build on.
Well, he's definitely a legendary guy. I'm absolutely lucky to be working with someone who's so inspiring, but also has incredible integrity. And so, you know, when you surround yourself with people who are great, who strive for greatness in all aspects of their life, then I think, you know, everyone wins.
Steel sharpens steel.
Yeah. And so I feel so fortunate to have found a partner who pushes our thinking, who's always wanting more, who's incredibly competitive without sacrificing who he is. I think it comes from like the people who raised him. You know, Mike Maples Sr. and Carolyn Maples are probably one of the two of the most amazing people I've ever met. And so, you know, I see sort of his heritage and who he is, and I'm deeply appreciative that that's in my life every day.
Well, Anne, we are deeply appreciative that you're in our life, and particularly that you came on as a founding guest of Legends and Losers.
Thanks for having me.
From the bottom of our heart, Anne, and we sure hope you'll come back. But you continue to inspire us to play bigger all the time, and we think you're a legend.
Thank you. See you guys soon.
Bye, Anne. Thanks, Anne.
Bye.
Wow. Well, it certainly is great to have had Anne on the show. She's such a thought leader and such an inspiration, and we do hope to have her back. There's lots more to talk to Anne about, not just about her own life and career and things we can learn, but also things about what's going on in Silicon Valley and startups and technology. So thanks for joining us, Anne. And hey, thank you for listening and checking out Legends and Losers. Please subscribe to the show on iTunes. Give us a legendary review. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/groups/legendsandlosers. You can find us on Twitter at legendslosers. And you can email us blackhole@legendsandlosers.com. And please tell all your friends about Legends and Losers. We like to thank our dear friends at Equity Directory, the invite-only network of entrepreneurs and startup talent exchanging work for equity. The bestseller from HarperCollins, Play Bigger: How Pirates, Dreamers, and Innovators Create and Dominate Markets. OneLifeFullyLived.org, Planet, Dream It, and Live It. Our friends in the UK, Positive Marketing, PR, Marketing, and Category Design in London, Europe, and beyond. Our good friends at NetSuite, number one in the cloud and number one in cloud ERP. Double Dutch, Live Engagement Marketing. The Horn Group, legendary PR in Silicon Valley, New York, and beyond. Avocados, the yummy and good for you fat food. Volkswagen, lying about pollution emissions since 2010. Yama, America's first martial art. 800ceoread.com, business books. Don't be a loser, read something. And the Marketing Journal, good shit to read from Hart Hanks. All right, that's it. We're going to wrap the show. Today's information has been provided to you solely for informational purposes. This oddcast is the sole property of the Legends and Losers Oddcast Network. In the event of a 4-hour erection, call someone you like. Never jog around a prison. Think about it. Only fart in an elevator with 3 or more people. Support your local category designer. Watch The Big Lebowski. Subscribe to Matty A's podcast, Millionaire Mindcast. And remember, surf naked. We'd like to apologize to Justin Bieber. Sorry, Justin, we just ran out of time for you. That's it, everyone. Thanks, and be legendary.